Hello everyone, welcome to Diagnoser. Today we have this very interesting case, and this is a 5-year-old boy who presented with this self-mutilation of fingers and lips, as you can see here, this, with intellectual disability and uric acid stones in the kidney. So with all, we can make a diagnosis, and this is a case of Lesch-Nihan syndrome. So let's start our discussion with this syndrome. Firstly, we'll discuss about what is this syndrome. Well, this is basically an X-linked disorder, basically X-linked recessive disorder, an inborn error of metabolism, and it is a kind of spectrum of disorder, and it occurs due to the deficiency of this enzyme HGPRT. This basically means that hypoxanthine guanine phosphoribosyl transferase. This is the enzyme due to the deficiency of which this Lesch-Nihan syndrome occurs. We'll discuss how this enzyme deficiency leads to this Lesch-Nihan syndrome. Why I'm saying this is as a spectrum of disorder? Because when this enzyme, the level of this enzyme is less than around 0.5%, or when it is completely absent, then this is called as this classical Lesch-Nihan syndrome. When the level of this enzyme is 8 to 60%, then this is Kelly-Segmiller syndrome. There is one more interesting thing about this. According to the inheritance pattern, this X-linked recessive pattern, we can say that males are more commonly affected. But this is not like 100% true. Like not all the patients of this Lesch-Nihan syndrome are males. It is reported in females also. So now you say why or how it can occur in females. Because this X-linked recessive disorder, if a female inherits this gene, then there are two X chromosomes and one is affected and one is having this Lesch-Nihan syndrome gene. Affected X chromosome, and the remaining one is, this is normal. So in some cases what happens is, in a usual female, normally what happens is one of the X chromosome got silenced, and this is called as lionization. But in some cases, if this normal X chromosome got silenced, then this affected X chromosome will get expressed, and this leads to development of or expression of this Lesch-Nihan syndrome gene in the females also. So yeah, females are also reported to be having this Lesch-Nihan syndrome. So we have discussed about what is this Lesch-Nihan syndrome. Now let's come to the next part, why this syndrome occurs. So as I have told you, this occurs due to this deficiency of enzyme, this HGPRT, hypoxanthine guanine phosphoribosyl transferase. So this is basically an enzyme of salvage pathway. And what this salvage pathway means? Well, there is this compound called as purines. And in the purines, these are basically needed for DNA synthesis. So what happens is, there are two pathways for the synthesis of purine. One is that de novo pathway in which the purines are synthesized, and one is this salvage pathway. What happens in this salvage pathway, when the purines are degraded, during this process of degradation, these products are again back converted into the purines. This pathway, this is called as salvage pathway of the purine synthesis. And let me tell you, the end product of this purine degradation, this is uric acid. And in these cases, this HGPRT, this is the main enzyme in this salvage pathway. So what happens is, due to the deficiency of this enzyme, the salvage pathway is not working. So these purines get degraded, and this leads to this increased amount of the uric acid. In most of the organs, this de novo pathway of the purine synthesis is occurring. But in some organs like brain, bone marrow, leukocytes, these are the organs in which this salvage pathway is the only pathway for synthesis of purines. And these organs also need purines. So the main manifestation of this Lesch-Nihan syndrome are related to these organs, because these are only organs where the salvage pathway is needed the most for the synthesis of purines. If purines are not synthesized, then the DNA synthesis in these organs will get affected. So that is why the features of this Lesch-Nihan syndrome are related to these organs only. Now firstly, let's discuss the clinical feature related to these organs. So according as the uric acid is increasing, this leads to gout or arthritis developing in the patients, or hyperuricemia in the blood. And in the bone marrow and in the leukocytes, the main thing is the patient, around 90 to 100% of the patients are having megaloblastic anemia. And in the brain, there are a lot of manifestations in the brain, starting from the childhood. The child present with delayed milestones, dystonia, and this characteristic self-mutilation behavior, as you can see, this self-mutilation of fingers and lips, and other is intellectual disability. These are a lot of manifestations that are related to these organs in this Lesch-Nihan syndrome. So we have discussed why this Lesch-Nihan syndrome occurs, and now let's come to the clinical features, like by what age, what features the child will present. Well, at birth and prenatally, the child is completely normal. But at birth, what happens is, the only thing that you can notice is this increased uric acid level. And how much increase? More than 8 mg per deciliter. this increased uric acid level, these are seen at birth of the child. And due to this increased uric acid, what happens is there are uric acid crystals. These crystals get formed, and in the starting these crystals are small, then they lead to injury of the this urinary tract. And due to the injury or due to the crystals also, there is orange colored crystals you can see in the diaper. So these are usually the first manifestation that you can see in the child. And with time, these crystals get big and they leads to this nephrolithiasis and arthritis. So these are the initial manifestations. And after around 3 to 4 months, we can see the neuro manifestations. And these manifestations basically include the delayed milestones, the intellectual disability in the child, this hypotonia, and associated with dystonic movements. And these dystonic movements can be this chorea, athetosis, bellismus kind of movements. These all can be seen in this child. And due to these dystonic movements, the child usually develop this dysphagia, dysarthria. The child cannot speak, cannot eat the food by himself. Opisthotonus kind of movement can also occur. And due to this hypotonia and dystonia kind of movements, the milestone of the child, like the child should have crawled or walked by that time, these are not achieved due to these specific neuro manifestations. And apart from these neurological manifestation, there is this self-mutilation behavior. This is quite characteristic, and not I can say it is seen only in this Leishmanian syndrome, but yeah, it is seen in this Leishmanian syndrome. Other syndromes are also associated with self-mutilation behavior that I'll tell you in the end of the video. Okay, so there is interesting thing that why this self-mutilation or why these neuro manifestations are occurring in the child. Well, what happens is due to this decrease in purines in the brain, there is decrease in the dopamine synthesis and decrease in dopamine receptors also. But the dopamine receptors that are remaining in the brain, these become super sensitive. So due to the super sensitive nature of dopamine receptors and decrease in the dopamine in the brain, these self-mutilation behavior, these occurs in the child. And yeah, this self-mutilation behavior, there are a lot of things about this. Like the pain sensation in the child is normal. The child feels pain, but still there is this obsession and compulsion of doing this self-mutilating behavior. So this is due to basically the super sensitivity of the dopamine receptors. And most of the time it is this super sensitivity, this occurs in basal ganglia, cingulate cortex, nucleus ambiguous, and a whole lot areas in the brain also. And apart from these self-mutilation behavior, aggressive behavior in the child, like punching the doctor or punching the other person, punching the treating physician, and verbally abusing them. And after that compulsive thought is over, the child is seen apologizing. So these are kind of manifestation in this Leishmanian syndrome. I've also told you about this megaloblastic anemia. These are also seen in this Leishmanian syndrome. So these are basically the clinical manifestations. Now let's come to the next part about the diagnosis. How we diagnose this case of Leishmanian syndrome? Well, in the diagnosis, the first thing, as I've told you, this increased uric acid level. These you can see. In the CBC or in the blood picture, you can see this presence of megaloblastic anemia in the child. Next thing is, there is no specific biochemical marker or anything you can do. There is no specific radiological investigation also. But the thing for the diagnosis is this enzymatic assay and this genetic mutation studies. And in the enzymatic assay, you can see the amount of this HGPRT enzyme in the child. So these are basically the investigation that are needed for the diagnosis. So this is all about the diagnosis. Now let's come to the end part, the last part, the treatment. How we treat a child with Leishmanian syndrome? Well, firstly, the first drug that should be started is this allopurinol. Because this allopurinol decreases the synthesis of uric acid. This basically decreases the conversion of this hypoxanthine and guanosine to the uric acid. So the manifestation related to increased uric acid in the child, these are corrected by the use of this allopurinol. And after that, the next drugs that can be used, this S-adenosylmethionine with any antipsychotic drug, like we can use risperidone. These are the drugs that are shown to be decreasing the self-mutilation behavior in the child. And if the drugs are not working, then the surgical things like this removal of teeth of the child, the anterior incisors of the child are removed. So these are the modalities for this decreasing the self-mutilation behavior. Next thing is, we can use this benzodiazepines. And why these benzodiazepines are used? Because the child is also having a lot of pyramidal symptoms, like the spasticity is there in the child, hypertonic movements are also there. So these are also, these benzodiazepines are used to decrease these hypertonic movements. Next is, this psychiatric and physical interventions are also done for the behavioral symptoms of the child, because the child is self-injurious, the child is having aggressive behavior. So these are also practiced for this Leishmanian syndrome child. And the latest modalities for the treatment are, these are just currently under trial, like the deep brain stimulation, the dopamine replacement therapy, and the use of this gabapentin, and the use of botulinum toxin. There are a lot of different new modalities for the treatment of Lechner syndrome, but they are currently under trial. Now, as I have told you, this self-mutilation behavior, this is not only seen in this cases of Lechner syndrome. A lot of other syndromes are also associated with this self-mutilation behavior, and the most common one is this cerebral palsy. Yeah, cerebral palsy is also associated with self-mutilation behavior. There are a lot of reports saying that. And the other syndrome that are associated are this Rett syndrome. Next is this Tourette syndrome, this Cornelia de Lange syndrome, hereditary sensory motor neuropathy, and familial dysautonomia. And yeah, this autism spectrum disorder, this is also associated with self-mutilation. So if we see a child with self-mutilation behavior, this Lechner syndrome is not the only diagnosis. There are a whole lot of other syndromes that are associated with self-mutilation behavior. So this should be taken in mind. Okay. So this is all you need to know about this Lechner syndrome. If you have any questions regarding this, then do post it in the comment section below and I'll try to answer them. Or you can also DM me in my Instagram handle @diagnoseit. And don't forget to like and share this video and subscribe to my channel. Thank you.